amerikāņu tradicionālā dziesma Oh Happy Day. Solo Valts Vitmans spēlē Kristapa Krievkalna instrumentālā grupa, diriģents Andrē Tomas.
Gospel. So y'all. Come on, put your hand together like this. Come on, stand up like this. Come on. two, three. All right, this one, y'all gonna put it up. Put it up. Put it up. Put it up like this. Let me hear you say, oh, happy day. Come on, enlighten me up, say happy day. Put it up like this. Good morning. What a beautiful day today to spend together. To begin our time of praise and worship this morning, let me begin by reading from Philippians, the fourth chapter, in the fourth verse, where we read these words. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. You know, one of my prayers every Sunday morning is that if somebody were to come in this place today and look at our faces and our reactions toward each other, that they'd say, you know what, the Lord is really in that place. And let's let that be our prayer today. God, be here with us this morning. Shall we pray? Our precious Heavenly Father, we come into your presence with thanksgiving in our heart to give you praise. That's the whole reason for us being here today. And so we ask that everything we do in this service would glorify and lift you up. Father, we pray for everyone who's here today and for everyone who's not. We just pray your protection and your watch care over those who are traveling, who are ill, and who are unable to be with us. But Father, for those who are here, bless this service today with your presence. Enter into this place and touch our hearts and lives today. Encourage us, strengthen us. And Father, when we leave this place today, may we truly be able to say it's been good to be in the presence of the Lord. For truly we felt you near. And we ask this all in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Let's stand up and meet and greet a minute. Good morning. That footage that we were watching before the service was the World Choir Games. It's choirs from all over the world that come together and they compete and they sing together. So there were thousands and thousands and thousands of people. I was lucky to go to the one when it came into Cincinnati. And what was cool about that, thousands of people from all over the world were singing, "Oh, happy day when Jesus washed my sins away." A lot of them probably didn't even understand or know what they were singing. But the joy of the people who knew what that meant just kind of spread throughout the whole assembly. So they were feeling and experiencing the joy of the Lord maybe for the first time. So we're going to, Gary's going to be preaching more lies today. What about God wants you to be happy? He wants you to be joyful, okay? So I want you to turn to somebody and say, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Just turn to somebody and say that. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Okay. Tell somebody else, the joy of the Lord is my strength. Okay, and one more. His divine power has given us everything we need. His divine power has given us everything we need. Yeah, if we were to spread that more, it would be just like that World Choir Games assembly. People would start singing, and as they're singing, they're starting to get it. So we're going to start with this old song, I Have the Joy, Joy, Joy.
Good morning. God's in the house. Is he in yours? The question I have this morning is, how can we describe our relationship with God? This morning I'm going to use a comparison to our homes with the different rooms for different purposes. First, there's the living room. It's a place we can relax with God, where we meet together after a day's work and talk things over. That is, if we turn the TV off and get rid of the distractions. The laundry room and bathroom areas might be a delicate area. We can clean and air the dirty linen, where we get our sins washed or flushed away. Could even say it's where we clean up our act with God. Then there's the bedroom. Yes, it's an intimate area with God, where we can relate personally, a place of tears, love, where all our emotions are employed and we face God as we are. Lastly, the dining room and kitchen, where we feed ourselves for the day's service. Food for the journey, that's what the early Christians called the Lord's Supper. Food for the journey, nourishment for the time ahead when things get hard and we feel drained of energy. John 6, verses 33 through 35 say, Jesus said, God's bread is the one who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. So do you have a similar relationship with God? Do you spend that intimate time with him, that alone time, a time where you can come to Him and confess all of your sins and ask for that forgiveness? Matthew 26, verses 26 through 28. As they were eating, Jesus took some bread. He thanked God for it and broke it, gave it to His followers and said, "Take, eat, this is My body." Then Jesus took the cup. He thanked God for it and gave it to the followers. He said, "Every one of you drink this. This is My blood, which begins the new agreement that God makes with His people. This blood is poured out for many to forgive their sins." John.
Shall we pray? Father, we come to You this morning. We're not worthy of all the blessings You constantly seem to shower on us. We thank You for those blessings. We thank You for the opportunity to be here in Your house today. And as Jesus Himself said, as we were about to partake of this communion, He instructed us to remember that it reminds us of His body and His blood that He shed for us on the cross, the sacrifice that He made. We make such small sacrifice. All we have to do is be here, Lord, and present ourselves for worship and to do whatever it is that You would have us do. Let our hearts be open and let's listen to You. Let's do what You would have us to do and to go about the things that would be pleasing to You as we go out in the community this coming week. Now, as we're about to partake of this bread and the wine, we ask Your blessings on the gift that You've given us, that the people who partake think about it. We just take the bread and the wine and drink it and look around to see who's next to us, but take it and think about it and appreciate the total sacrifice that You made for us. Guide us and keep us through this day. We pray in Your name. Amen.
give us, Lord. Lord, we just thank you that you give us more than we need and more than we ever could ask for. Lord, we just know that, you know, if we had a tenth to live on, a tenth for our food, a tenth for our water, how would we ever make it, Lord? And yet you only ask for a tenth, Lord, and somehow you bring that back to us tenfold. Lord, we just thank you and praise you for all that you do for us. It's in your Son's holy name we pray. Amen.
Well, as they're taking up the offering, the kids are dismissed to junior church. They figured they'd get me up here a little quicker, Hudson. Maybe we get out on time. What do you think? Yeah, he's timing it. I know. It's great to see you all here this morning. As we continue, we started the 1st of May, and then because of Mother's Day and Youth Sunday, we kind of got off track talking about some of the lies that Satan tells us. And remember with me, I told you before that a lie doesn't have to be the truth in order for us to treat it like truth. There are some lies that Satan has been telling us for so long that they've gotten into our hearts and into our lives, and we actually believe that what he's saying is true to us. And one of the lies that we've been dealing with is probably one of the most dangerous. Is the lie that you deserve to be happy. And the reason that that's such a dangerous lie is because when you hear me say that's a lie, there's a lot of you that are going, wait a minute. Are you trying to tell me that God doesn't want me to be happy? Or are you trying to tell me that God wants me to be unhappy? Is that what you're saying? And you see, that's how Satan twists his truth. We turn it from our idea of you deserve to be happy into God wants me to be happy, and then we say, well, if that's not true, then God doesn't want me to be happy. That's not true at all. The truth is that there's a difference between God's happiness and our happiness. See, our happiness is based, or true happiness is not based on circumstances, but based on a relationship with Jesus Christ. That's why Paul kind of gives his own testimony in Philippians, the 4th chapter. And in verses 11 through 13, he says this, I have learned to be content, whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I've learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do everything through him who gives me strength. Now you need to understand something. When Paul is writing these words about contentment, he's writing them from prison. And Roman prisons were not a very nice place. And what Paul's writing to say to us is that his happiness is not based on his surroundings. His happiness is not based on what he has or he doesn't have. His happiness is based on his relationship with Jesus Christ, and it's through him that we have strength to see us through. And for that reason, happiness this morning shouldn't be based on the size of your bank account, the reliability of your car, the shape of your body, or even the prognosis of the doctor. Happiness is independent from our circumstances. There was a Scottish scholar by the name of William Barclay who really seems to have understood this. Because really, if you look in the New Testament, every time you see the word blessed, that's really the word for happiness. It's almost like saying, happy are those. And William Barclay writes this. This word describes that joy which has a secret within itself. That joy which is serene and untouchable and self-contained. That joy that is completely independent of all chances and all the changes of life. Literally what Barclay says is, Our happiness is not based on stuff. Our happiness as Christians should be untouchable. It's not going along with the circumstances of our life. That's why in John, the 16th chapter, Jesus is the night before his betrayal, when he's about to die the next day on the cross, and he's having some last words with his 12 disciples. Now, Jesus understands what's going to happen to these guys. They have no idea. He knows that in the day to come, they're going to be persecuted, they're going to be tortured, and 10 out of the 11 that are left with him, remember, Judas is already gone, 10 out of the 11 that are left are going to die horrible deaths because of their relationship with him. And yet in John 16, verse 22, this is what he says to them. You will rejoice and no one will take away your joy. They can't change it, he said. They can't touch it. You will rejoice and no one will take away your joy, because the joy that he offers is independent of our chances. It's independent of our circumstances. And the sooner we understand that, the more joy we're going to have in our lives. See, here's the problem. The problem is that we think we should be, or we would be happy if we could just win the comparison battle. And so for many of us, our happiness or maybe our unhappiness today depends on how we compare with other people. And we talked about this before. We're all in a comparison game, aren't we? How many of us are hooked on Facebook or Instagram? Where we read all the stories about everything wonderful that's happening in everybody else's life. And then we compare that to the life that we're living. And folks, that's just not healthy, is it? I mean, think about it. If the last thing you do at night or the first thing you do in the morning is to read about the very best things that are going on in everybody else's life and then compare your life to it, what does that do to you? It makes us miserable. Comparison robs us of our happiness, because there's this pressure inside that says to you, you know what? You should be as happy as everybody else. And so we do our best not to show people what's really going on. In fact, we get on those same things and we type our little story and we make ourselves sound just as happy as everybody else, because we don't want anybody to know that we're not happy, when on the inside we're really hurting and we really need help, but we don't want to ask for it because then they'd think we weren't happy. See, we're caught in that comparison game. But the Bible teaches this. The Bible teaches that true happiness is fueled by gratitude. True happiness is fueled by gratitude. We look around and we compare ourselves with other people and we have a hard time finding much joy. But the Bible tells us that we can be thankful in all circumstances, no matter what we may be going through today. 1 Thessalonians 5, verses 16 through 18 says, be joyful always. Pray continually. Give thanks in all circumstances. For this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. God says you want to be joyful. Do you really want to be happy? Then learn to be thankful regardless of the circumstances. Because joy and thankfulness go together. And so this is what I want to challenge you with this morning, especially if you're a Christian and you don't feel really happy today. And as a matter of fact, if I were to go out and ask your friends or your coworkers, that they might even categorize you as a relatively unhappy person. I want to encourage you to pay careful attention to things in your life that you have to be thankful for. Instead of thinking about all those things that are dragging you down, take time to thank God for the things that are going well. There was a study done by Emmons and McCullough. where they tested two groups of people. I love this test. They went to one group of people and they said, here's what we want you to do. We want you to keep a journal. We want you to keep a journal of all the things that you're thankful for. Through the day, just keep in mind things that you can be thankful about. Your car started this morning. You got to work on time. Somebody smiled at you in the hallway. Whatever it is, just keep a list of all the things you have to be thankful for. And they went to the second group and they said, we want you to keep a list of all the things that annoy you. Now, you know, I think I've met a few people in life that were on that second list, haven't you? But they just go through life and they look for everything that annoys you. Don't look for the good in another person, but look for that thing that really ticks you off. And we want you to keep a track of all those annoyances that you go through, all those people that bug you every day. You keep track of it. So the one group is keeping a gratitude journal, and the other two is keeping an annoyance journal. Now here's what they found. When they looked at both groups at the end, they found that those who kept the gratitude journal showed remarkably greater increase in energy and enthusiasm. They slept better, and they had significantly less depression. Now, let me ask you, does that surprise you? It doesn't surprise me. We'd expect that, wouldn't we? And yet, let me ask you, which of the two journals are you keeping in your life? Do you go through every day looking for something to be thankful for and all the great things that are happening to you every day? Or the things that you remember, are they the things that annoy you and bother you and drag you down? The Bible says if you really want to be happy, if you really want to be joyful, then be thankful. In fact, Paul writes in Philippians 4, verses 8 and 9, finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything's excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. And whatever you've learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put into practice, and the peace of God will be with you. Paul says, listen to me. When you take time to think about the good things in your life, the health of your family, the beautiful day God's given us to live today, the fact that you got up this morning and were able to move, you come to understand that God's peace is much bigger than you ever even imagined. In fact, in verse 7, he describes it this way, the peace of God which transcends all understanding will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. But you know what the problem is? Instead of really believing that today, most of us have bought into this lie. I can be happy by focusing on myself. When you buy into that lie, that you deserve to be happy, and so your whole life is built on how happy you are, you become the center of your own little universe. And the more you're the center of your own little universe, the more happiness you find really coming out in your life. The Los Angeles Times did a study a while back, finding a depression epidemic among young adults in the world today. In fact, this is what they said. If you compare kids today to kids 30 years ago, kids today are 10 times more likely to be depressed. Can you believe that? With all the games, all the toys, all the things they have today, kids today are more depressed. And they ask the question, why? Why in the world would kids be depressed today? Here's what they came up with. The cultural occurrence that has exalted the individual. They said this is why kids are depressed, because the only person they think about is themselves. Can you believe that? that most kids today are mainly selfish? All they worry about is what I'm going to get out of it. We build it into our culture. It's in the commercials we see on TV. It's in the social media that we're exposed to. It all tends to exalt the individual. And what they end up believing is this: it's all about us. It's all about us. And there's no surer way to be unhappy than to make life all about yourself, pursuing your own happiness. The more we try and pursue our own happiness, the more unhappy we tend to be. So instead, what we need to do is we need to set aside some of the temporary pleasures of this world and the things that we think are going to make us happy right now. And instead, we're going to look to the future, to what God has in store for us. The best example of this is probably Moses. In Hebrews, the 11th chapter, verses 24 through 26, it says this: "By faith, Moses, when he had grown up, refused to be known as the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He chose to be mistreated along with the people of God rather than to enjoy the pleasure of sin for a short time. He regarded disgrace for the sake of Christ as of greater value than all the treasures of Egypt." Now listen, here's the reason why. Because he was looking ahead to his reward. Moses had the opportunity to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, to grow up in the palace with all the perks that went along with that. But the Bible says instead he chose to experience oppression for the people of God. Why? Why? Because Moses understood that there is a deeper happiness that could be his. The world says if you want to be happy, focus on yourself. Well, biblical happiness focuses on others. A while back, I read about a psychologist named Martin Seligman who wrote a book entitled Authentic Happiness. And in it, he dialogues the fact that he went through life over 10 years looking for what really made people happy. What really makes you happy? And here's what he said. He says, most of us think that we'll be happy if we could just fill the void in our life with something we really like. And so we think we will be happy if we just have more money to fill that void. Or more success, or more chocolate, or more achievement, or more recognition, or more stuff. He said, whatever it is to you, you think if I can just fill the void in my life with the stuff that I think would make me happy, then I'll be happy. But here's what he concluded. He concluded that the gap between more and enough never really gets bridged. The gap never really gets filled. Listen, there is a God-shaped void in each of our hearts. And there is nothing else in this world that's going to fill that void. And so he decided to experiment with one of his classes. Here's what he did. He told his class that I want you to go out and I want you to do something that's pleasurable. I want you to do something that you know is going to bring pleasure to you. It doesn't matter whether it brings pleasure to anybody else or not, but you go out and you just make yourself happy. And then he said, I want you to go out and I want you to do one activity that you get nothing out of yourself, that's strictly focused on bringing happiness to someone else. And this is what he said. The results were life-changing. The afterglow of the pleasurable activity, whether it was watching a movie or spending time with friends or eating a hot fudge sundae, whatever it might be, paled in comparison to the effect of one selfless act expressed towards someone else. He said his students found more pleasure in being involved in selfless acts than in doing things they thought were going to please them. And he said the people that did that were less depressed. They had a greater sense of community and a decreased loneliness in their life. And here's what he says. Read along with me. He said, it's so ironic that when people's primary focus is on doing something they will like or something that will make themselves happy, they get depressed. And yet when they focus on doing something to make others happy, their own happiness gets thrown in. And listen, this is a non-Christian. Listen to the way he ends it. He says, it's as if we've been made and designed that way. Surprise! Jesus says in Matthew 20, verse 28, the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. What Jesus said, the greatest among you will be the president, will be the top dog. No, he said the greatest among you will be the servant of all. When you do for others, you gain from it yourself. There's real joy in putting others first. But another lie that we deal with is that happiness is based on feelings. That's what most of us think. And so we ask each other, well, how do you feel today? Do you feel sad? Do you feel happy? Do you feel on top of the world? Do you feel depressed? But biblical happiness, the kind of happiness that God wants us to have, is based on faith. You know the neat thing about that? When my happiness is based on faith, I can be sad and still be happy. I can be discouraged and still be happy. Because it's not based on how I feel. It's based on the confidence I have in God. That I serve a God who keeps his promises. A God that meant what he said in Romans chapter 8, verse 28. And he said, we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him and are called according to his purpose. I have faith in that. That's the foundation of happiness. So it's not based on how I feel right now at this moment or on one particular day. Because you know what? You're going to have some rough days. You're going to have some tough times. And you can have some people in your life that really irritate you. But God says that's not what it's all about. It's all about who your faith is in today. And who you trust with all your tomorrows. You know, one of the greatest things in life is when we finally come to the realization that I don't know what tomorrow holds, but I know who holds tomorrow, so I don't have to worry about it. And then there are some people that think you find happiness by chasing after it. And so if I'm not happy this morning, well, then I just need to pursue it more. I just need to get out there and do what I want to do. After all, isn't that what our country is based upon? Life, liberty, and what? The pursuit of happiness. So I just have to work a little harder, right? Just try a little harder and I'll be happy. Sorry to let you know this morning, but that's not how happiness works. Instead, what you find is this. The more you chase after it, the more elusive it becomes. Instead, the Bible says that happiness is a joy that comes simply by receiving it. I love what the Bible says. Salvation is a free gift from God. Not by works, so that what? Nobody can boast. You don't deserve it this morning. You can't earn it today. But instead, through grace and our faith in Jesus Christ, it's something that we have. And something that no one can ever take away from us. You know, while I was working on this message, I began to realize something, and maybe you've realized it this morning. I began to get to the point where I'd worked on it and worked on it, and I got into part one and part two, and I said to myself, I am never going to be able to get this message across. I'm never really going to get what I want to get through to people. That happens sometimes. And you know what irritates me? It always happens after hours and weeks of study and preparation. Then you get to the point you say, I just can't do this. And I'll let you in on a little secret. When I have those things happen to me, and they happen at times, I ask myself one question. What is the one thing I want to make sure to say when it comes to this lie that you deserve to be happy? And so I began to look through my Bible. And I look from cover to cover, and I'm going, okay, where is it? Where's that one passage that says, you know what, you deserve happiness? And you're not going to like what I say next. But listen to me, because this is the truth that will set you free. After looking from one end to the other, here's what I came up with. You don't deserve to be happy. Actually, what we deserve is hell. That's what we deserve. That's what we've earned. And the truth is, it's not difficult to back that biblically. I mean, here's how it works. If I wake up every day thinking I deserve to be happy, I end up miserable. But if I wake up every morning and realize that I deserve to go to hell, but Jesus paid my price so that one day instead I get to live with him for all eternity in heaven, that in a nutshell is all I need to make me happy. Isn't it? It's the assurance of salvation. The understanding that everything down here, all the stuff we chase, it's all temporary, and we're going to leave it here someday. I've been a minister for over 30 years. Do you know how many funerals I have done in 30 years? And I have yet to see a hearse pulling a U-Haul trailer behind it. A rich man died in the community, and I heard somebody say soon afterwards, I wonder how much he left. And the smartest answer I heard, somebody said he really left it all. He never took any of it with him. It's all temporary. It all stays here. But real happiness comes from something you can't earn and you don't deserve, but Jesus has purchased for you anyway. Your salvation. And that's why that, in a nutshell, should make you happy. It really comes down to this. If you were a millionaire, just imagine with me this morning, just for a minute. If you were a millionaire, and you were going to vacation in Chicago, so you get in your Learjet, and you fly into Chicago, and you get off your plane, and you go out of the airport, and there are no limousines, so you call a taxi. And you take the taxi downtown to your hotel, and you get out of the cab, and you pull out your wallet, and you only have 320s in your wallet. Because rich people don't carry money. They really don't. You only have 320s in your wallet, and it's a $15 fee, and so you take out one of the 20s, and you hand it to the cab driver, and you say, keep the change. You figure a $5 tip's pretty good. And then later on the day, you get out your wallet again, you look inside, and you only have 120 left. You begin to think to yourself, well, what happened to the other 20? Either I dropped it somewhere along the way and lost it, or I gave that cab driver a $25 tip for a $15 trip. Now let me ask you, what are you going to do? Are you going to get so irritated that it ruins the rest of your day? And you make everybody else around you miserable? And it just practically ruins the rest of your vacation because of that $20. No, you're a millionaire. That $20 means nothing. You let it go. Here's the point. Do you understand really understand that spiritually we are billionaires. Spiritually, we are billionaires today. And you know what we do? We let little $20 issues ruin our life. You know what? It's time to let the $20 stuff go. And realize that what you've got in comparison makes that look like nothing. And when you do that, you find true happiness. True happiness is this. You deserve hell. But on a cross so many years ago, Jesus paid your price. So you don't get what you deserve. You get eternity with him. If that doesn't put a smile on your face, then nothing ever will. But maybe the reason you can't smile this morning is because you've never accepted that. You don't have that gift today, that assurance, that confidence that all your debts are paid and you will live with him for all eternity. If you don't have that today, you have every reason to be unhappy this morning. But you know what? I want you to leave out these doors today with a smile on your face and the assurance that you have all it takes. If you'll just step out this morning and come today and accept Jesus and let him take that place in your life that he deserves, that's what truly makes you happy. I want you to do that while we stand and sing our invitation to this morning. Thank you all for your kind attention this morning. I want you to do one thing very quickly. Take a good look around you up here this morning, because you will not see this again for about 3 weeks as we get ready for our vacation Bible school. We've got a very exciting afternoon planned as we'll be setting up all the decorations and getting ready for the kids. Unbelievably, we've been talking about this for 3 months. It's just a week away. A week from tomorrow night begins our vacation Bible school this year. If your kids are not registered yet, please do that, because it helps us to get an idea, at least for the first night, where we're starting out with. So if you haven't registered yet, do that. If you want to stay and help today, there's going to be food downstairs for you to eat. And then after we eat, we're going to get busy, and we have got a busy afternoon ahead of us. Julie, is there anything you want to say? Okay. Yeah, I kind of got the feeling my men's group have kind of laid off for the summer, but Joe Johnson is going to continue his small group, And there will be youth meeting tonight at 6 o'clock. And I got a funny feeling that a lot of us are still going to be around, still working, putting things up. So please come out and give us a hand this afternoon. We would appreciate all the help that we can get.
One more, yeah.
Yes.
We've got some of our folks are going to be in a communist country in Asia starting next week. So just think, keep them in.
Yeah, they'll be here one more Sunday before they go.
Well, one of them's leaving this Friday. So Dave's leaving this Friday.
Oh, you're talking about Dave.
Okay. Yeah, Dave and then, yeah.
Okay.
And then Doug. So
it's
two.
Not just Doug. It's Doug and Gwen and Lillian and Isabella are all going to be
so
in China.
So keep them in your prayers and pray for safety and pray for a witness.
All right. Yeah, what a great opportunity. You know, God plants us in places for a purpose, and I really believe that's true. All right. Also, if you're interested, on the 18th of June, that's a week from this coming Friday, Hope Ministries is going to be begging. Do you remember when we did the food for the poor, where you came in and you vacuum wrapped it? Hope is going to try and do 50,000 meals that way. And they need people who are willing to come out. I said, well, I'll mention it to our people because they've already done it before. So if you're open on the 18th, we'll have the location and everything for you next week. It's a great afternoon, and it's an exciting way of being able to minister to the needs of others. So that's coming up the 18th of June. We'll have more information for you next week. So keep that in mind, too. And don't forget our missions team getting ready to go. Do you have anything going with that? Okay. We're good, huh? All right, we're good. All right. Any other announcements? Okay, and I think Shelly's already left to go over there, and she'll be at the door handing them out. So you can pick up your VBS t-shirts this week, too. Let's close together in prayer. Our precious Heavenly Father, how exciting it is to really realize that we are part of your kingdom. That all of our debts have been paid, and that one day when we're standing in front of you, you're going to say, well done, my good and faithful servant, welcome into the joy of your master. But it's not because we've earned it. It's not because we've deserved it. It's because Jesus bought it for us on Calvary's cross. Lord, that ought to thrill us. That ought to excite us. That ought to put a smile on our face every morning and a spring in our step. That ought to make such a difference in our life that everybody walks up to us and says, what is it about you? And when they do, help us to turn them to you. May that be our goal this week, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
With the last 30 seconds of the World Choir Games.